Hi there, I'm Steve Miller from the UK, and this is the fifth in a series of conversations with five-star Master Pirelli professional David Lichtman. Good evening, David.
It's good afternoon over here.
Or should I call you Maestro with your new title?
Yes.
When were you awarded that?
The new instructor scale came out a couple of weeks ago, I think.
That's lovely.
Which would be about 2 months ago by the time this podcast airs.
Yes, we're a bit behind, perhaps. But anyway, that's obviously good. Nice to have some recognition. Firstly, a recap, because last time we spoke about Heather from Ontario, Canada, with her lawnmower of a fjord called Henry, who thought his job was just to dive down and eat grass all day. And you left her with some strategies to employ, a very wide-ranging strategy from start to finish. So, have you heard back at all?
Yes. I'll just read what she wrote to me. I will report back within a week or so and give you an update on how Operation Owning the Grass is going. I will say, however, that day one was how interesting. To make a very long story short, I did not let him approach the food until he, A, would look at me, and B, when he looked at me, he wiped that sour, grouchy look off his face. It was an interesting session, and I did repeat the process on day one 5 times until I saw a change in attitude, and then quit while I was ahead.
Good for her.
I am very excited after day one and feel hope brewing under the frustration.
Oh, yeah. Good for her.
Yes. So I think we send her back a 1 point for Heather.
Absolutely, yes. Yeah, horse tennis.
Well, it's interesting that in my classes, in the beginning classes especially, when people are still trying to learn about getting respect from the horse, I like to tell the students that if you can cause the horse to move his feet somewhere, one step, that he wasn't already thinking about moving them, you get 1 point.
Okay.
If he causes you to move one step somewhere where you are not or already thinking about moving your feet, he gets 1,000 points.
Oh.
Because he's that much more powerful than you. So you can have a fabulous play session for an hour with all 7 games and rack up 500, 1,000, 2,000, 5,000 points. And if he nudges you, you know, 5 or 6 times on the way back to the barn, you're negative.
He wins.
Yeah, you're 5,000 in the negative. So I just like to put it in perspective. I like to put those things in perspective because people don't realize that they have to be a little more insistent than just one-to-one. This also applies to moments of rest. We like to give moments of rest as a reward for the horse.
Yep.
But if we inadvertently give moments of rest to the horse when he's not deserving a reward, in fact, when he's done the opposite, let's say he comes barreling out of the trailer, and you're trying to put him back in, and you're fumbling around, and you're tying your shoe, and you pick up your.
I'm glad that's never happened to me.
Yes. Pick up your stick, and then you drop the rope, and you pick up the rope, and you drop your stick again, and you know, so it doesn't have to be that obvious. It's just a few seconds, and I like to say 10 seconds of inactivity out there when he's looking to see what's your response is to what he just did. Is like a 2-week vacation in Hawaii. So you need to put these things in perspective so that you can start to realize that you really do not want to let horses take advantage because they learn so quickly and because they're so much more powerful than us. We have to toe the line pretty accurately. That when he needs a rest, he needs a rest, and when he doesn't, he doesn't. And when he's just slightly moving us around in the context of something we're doing and we don't even notice it, that's when a lot of the disrespect gets cemented in place.
Yeah. It does seem to me, the little I've experienced, is that the horses do seem to prefer things to be distinct, for want of a better term, one or the other. And if we get into this kind of grey area, it doesn't seem to work out so well. Is that an accurate observation?
Dr. Miller would agree with you because he says horses are the great categorizers. From the moment of birth, this is either good or it's not good. And that's where the full imprinting thing comes. They want to categorize. Is this going to be good for me or is this dangerous to me? You know, okay, all right, this is, you know, Pat will say, okay, well, this is Mom, she's good. And this is Aunt Mabel, she's good. You know, and so the whole concept of categorizing would make it seem, though, they would like to have it black or white.
Yes.
What happens a lot of times is people don't realize that the horse is moving them. And yeah. I would say, you know, of the 8 or 10 common phrases that I find myself saying thousands of times a year, one of the most common is, did you know that you just took a step backwards there?
Yes, you're right.
And they went, no, I didn't. Or they went, I did. And so maybe if you put yourself on video.
Yeah.
You would see. Yeah. Yeah. But clearly people don't sense that they have moved out of the horse's way.
No, it's important to the horses, but it's not important to us. And it ought to be important to us.
Correct. It really is very important. They count them. I mean, their score. when I say the score is 1,000 to 1 in terms of the point standards, the horses are keeping score. They know.
Yeah.
You know. Yeah. You know, I got 10,000 points. I can run around here all day because you're asking, still win this deal.
So, are you yet selling some hammering kind of iron hoops which we can put over our boots? No, health and safety be damned.
Well, if you ever go to watch Pat's demonstrations, he has people stand on the pedestal.
Exactly, yes.
And then he says, right. Okay, this is a boat. And then you cannot get off the boat, right, because you'll drown. The most common thing you hear Pat say is,
back in the boat.
Yep. Exactly. Okay. So,
now, So the topic for this podcast, we decided, was we have a number of smaller questions, things that can be answered together. So they kind of fitted together nicely. So we had a mini question session, if that's okay. Should we move on to that?
Yep.
Right. So we had a question from Bobby May in the UK, who was looking into the difference between focus and being direct line. I'm getting a little confused between if I'm very focused on something, how do I do that without being direct line? And there was a secondary question came up about the idea of feel, and it's often used in natural horsemanship and probably difficult to define. So people are after your ideas on what feel was. And you said to me that you'd like to bring the two in together with focus, feel, and timing, I think.
Yes.
So do you want to deal with that one first?
Yes, that's great.
Okay.
The biggest thing about focus that I learned from Pat is that we think focus means a drilled on
concentrated stare and
that is that kind of negates the periphery.
Yes, yes.
Okay. And what Pat says is that focus gives you feel.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're too concentrated and not absorbing of the
environment,
the periphery or the environment, you'll miss the feel.
Uh-huh.
So I love the example he gives, and because I am so guilty. And this is the example of playing the guitar or playing the bass like I do. So if you, let's say you want to play the 5th fret with your first finger, and if you watch that with your focus, if you focus on what you're doing, and then you want to move up 3 frets and you watch that, and you want to move down 5 frets on the instrument, and maybe change a finger, and you're watching all this, you will never get the feel of where those things are.
If,
however, you put some sheet music in front of you and you watch what the notes are and you focus on the notes, so you're focusing on this is what needs to be happening, but you're not watching, you're not focusing on your fingers, you will develop the feel of where is that note, and then you won't have to look at the neck of your instrument every time you play.
Yes.
So it's very hard to look at the neck of your instrument and read music. This is why it's one of the reasons I'm a terrible reader, and also why I can't often find the notes unless I'm looking at them. I long ago gave up the idea that I would be as good a musician as I am a horseman. So I don't try so hard, and I have more fun at it.
Yeah, and the hours, I guess, has to go in the 10,000 hour thing or however many it might be. It's funny you mentioned that I was at my Aikido, regular Aikido class on Monday, and this I didn't realize till you said that, but we were practicing the same thing. And the instructor not only told us to close our eyes, but we had to get down on our knees. And that's very disorientating. So we were then having to, as the person came and attacked, they were just grabbing us. We couldn't see what we just had. All we could do is feel. And we couldn't be, it was amazing to watch because everybody did the technique better.
Wow.
Everybody. Just by closing your eyes, we had no option but to feel.
Yes. Okay, so do we have time for one more question? Does that answer the question? Let's start with that.
Focus and direct line.
Yeah. And feel. Feel really is, I'm going to say feel is a lot about experience. So feel is the idea that you know how hard to hold or how hard to push because you've experienced this before and you know what the results of doing it too much mm-hmm. or too little are. And it's a lot like that pendulum swing. If your horse is being, it doesn't matter, extreme in one thing,
mm-hmm.
and you say, well, in order to balance him, I've got to go the other way. So let's say our horse really doesn't want to go. And so in order to get him to go, we get him all jazzed up, we get him fed up with grain, and we do all kinds of stuff, and we get him, now he's out of control and running and galloping. And then we say, whoa, we got to swing the pendulum way back the other way.
Yeah.
And if in your mm-hmm. mind you can envision a pendulum swinging from left to right and mm-hmm. make these big giant swings, and it passes through the middle area where you want to be, and then with each back and forth swing, it gets closer and closer and kind of finally lands in the middle. This is how people without a lot of feel, or who don't have feel yet, will fix these problems. They'll go way overboard, overcompensating, then way back
yes.
the other way, overcompensating, whatnot. And what I used to say is that that might be how much you're doing it. And
yeah.
let's say if I'm doing it, picture the pendulum way up there off to the right, and I might swing down to the bottom, and I might come up maybe a third of the way up and back down the other side, to a sixth, and then a couple little swings. So I might be, pretty good at it. I might be able to. I overshot a little bit, but I'm gonna just a couple of swings more. I'll be right back in the middle. And then somebody like Pat, you might see him just that thing will be way high up on the right, and it'll just go. Zoop.
Yes.
He'll know exactly how far to push it so that he doesn't overcompensate and he gets right where he wants.
Yeah.
On a good day.
Hmm. You know, there was a time when people said that the experience the 10th quality, and in my naivety, I thought they were just talking about all the good stuff.
Can you say that again? Experience what?
The experience the 10th quality of the horseman. When I first heard about that, I naively thought they were just talking about all the good stuff that happens.
Oh, the 10th quality.
10th quality.
You're not speaking American anymore.
Oh, I beg your pardon.
Experience the 10th quality.
Yes.
Feel, timing, balance, heavy, and experience. Yes.
Yeah, that one.
yes. So, yeah, no, it's all the...
exactly, yes.
It's all the times you shot yourself in the foot that teach you how not to put your finger on the trigger as you are pulling the gun out of the holster.
Yeah, someone put to me when I must have been going through that one lesson somewhere, and someone said to me, it sounds like a pat definition, pardon the pun, now what was it? Experience is what happens when your plans don't work out. And I thought, yes, that kind of makes sense now. I think it's just after I fell off for the first time ever.
Mm-hmm. It used to be they would say that you're not a horseman until you've come off 20 times. I don't know if that's still in vogue or not. Anyway, I'm looking at the clock, and
yes.
I think we're coming fairly close to the end here. So we have a few topics for next time. I don't know how many we'll get to.
Mm-hmm.
But one of them is about the squeeze game in the send. Where and when should the pressure be aimed?
Yes.
And especially as it relates to trailer loading.
Mm-hmm.
We had a question about voice cues. We had a question about learning styles and teaching styles. So let me leave everyone with a little teaser just to think about in your own mind, what is your learning style? How do you like to be taught? What are the things that you need in order to be successful as a learner? Some people need to have their hands held and say, okay, do this while I'm watching. Some people need to see it and say, please leave me alone while I figure it out. I don't want you watching. So there's all kinds of things. People are visual learners. People are auditory learners, tactile learners, experiential learners. So just I pose that question to you, if you can try to figure out what kind of learning style do you have that really works well for you? And then we'll talk about that a little bit. And probably not this time, but starting next time, Rebecca from the UK asked me to talk about my horses, their stories, and what they have taught me. And I would maybe expand that to memorable horses, not just the ones I own.
Maybe you could do one per episode or something, made an impression on you.
We could, but we're out of time today. So we'll start with that next time.
Excellent. So, well, let's sign off. Thank you very much, David Lichtman. And this is Steve Miller signing off from the UK.
See you next time.
And if that weren't enough, we've also got Manamana, whatever that means.
Manamana. 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 Yeah.